Hello, friend, and welcome to Borgcast Lower Decks 2.3 with Peter and Anne-Marie.
Hello!
Hey, it rhymes and everything. We have a little bit of previously on Lower Decks, which I still haven't got a jingle for because, you know, like they're going to get a two-part Lower Decks episode. From Mr. Martin Thompson. I can't lie, I'm disappointed that this episode wasn't called Kayla's Fornication Helmet. Yes, that would be a reference to Kayshawn, his eyes open. But tonight's episode is, well, the first one, Mugato, Gumato.
Yes.
Captain's log, stardate 58036.4. The Cerritos is en route to Fryland 4 to investigate the reported sighting of a Mugato, a dangerous creature not indigenous to this planet.
So you start with, you see a load of people exercising in the gym, and you've got Rutherford and Boimler, and they're going to play Ambo-jitsu!
Oh, yes, we like Ambo-jitsu. Those cotton buds should be humming, though.
Yes.
They failed on that, I'm afraid.
They start beating Mariner, saying, you know, we've been practicing on all the rest of it, and then take the kid's gloves off. She's like, oh, okay then, and she just beats the crap out of them.
Yeah, she does come across a bit as a massive sadist. That's the problem. I mean, it's like, nice.
Yeah, you would think there'd be safeties on or something, wouldn't you? Yeah,
you'd think she wouldn't be sticking the Ambo-jitsu cotton buds right through their arms and stuff.
Yeah.
But there we go. That's apparently Mariner can't do anything by halves.
And then Shax comes in and they're all like, sorry. And he's like, that's all right, I'm a bit early. You've still got 10 minutes. And he just sits there.
Just calmly sits there. Yeah, that's good.
And then, now, I'm going to have to see if I remembered the race right. There were two, is it Denobulans?
Very good. I'm impressed considering we haven't watched much of Enterprise.
And they suddenly inflate like we saw Dr. Phlox.
Yes, that was one of the few good moments of Enterprise. That was a clever little bit of business, that wasn't it? And this is the first appearance of Denobulans, I think, outside of Enterprise, which does beg the question, where did they go between that series and this, you know?
Where did you come from? Where did you go? Where did you come from, Cotton Eye Joe?
Yeah, thanks for that.
Sorry.
I do hope we've either had that tune or I've rejected it before on the grounds it's shite.
I quite like it.
Really?
Yes.
It's so repetitive.
Yes.
My buzz bought the album.
The album?
The album.
The album. No, yeah, okay. Yeah,
every track exactly the same. Just rather than Cotton Eye Joe, it was, you know, Bad Eye Bob or something like that.
Wow. Okay. And yeah, the reason they inflate is because there's Mugatos. Or Mugato is the plural of Mugato. I don't know. It's like zebra and zebras and zebras.
As they point out, the pronunciation changes so much anyway, which I think is a reference to the original series episode it appears in.
Yeah.
I wouldn't worry.
And then, meanwhile, you've got Boimler and Rutherford playing what looks like that expansion from Roll for the Galaxy with the trading on it, doesn't
right.
it?
It does a bit. Certainly complicated enough.
Yeah. They have to sort of do, it's called diplomaths or something.
Mm-hmm.
And they've got to do a deal. But it's okay, because if neither of them are happy, it's a compromise and somehow they win or something.
Yes.
Okay. Meanwhile, you've got the guy behind the bar.
He's called Onus, but whenever they say his name, I think it sounds like anus.
All right. Arse behind the bar then.
Yeah.
He's all sort of saying about how Mariner is a secret black ops agent, and it's like you can see sort of like, well, it would make sense of why she's been on so many ships and been demoted.
It's sort of partly believable. It's not completely out there. He's voiced by Anthony Atamanuik, possibly, who apparently played Donald Trump in a parody series.
Oh.
Quite how you do a parody of a president, I do not know, but apparently he managed it. So.
Oh, right. And they talk about the Atlantis that Mariner was on.
But the noise you can hear in the background, by the way, is number two child chasing number two dog around the house.
Well, anything's better than number two dog eating manky apples or bringing them into the bed with slugs.
That is pretty gross. And it's slightly quieter than number two dog constantly barking, which is what we've been getting a lot of recently.
Yeah. It's like she barks at the moon or something. Mm-hmm. Not howls at the moon.
No, barks.
Barks at the moon. Yeah, with Mariner's record, they mentioned the Atlantis and all, it disappeared. And you're like, yeah, well, of course it did. You know, what happened? And then you've got Shax leading an away team with the Mugatos. And he says, you know, we've got, remember, team, we're unarmed because these, you know, they're sensitive creatures and their genitals are sensitive to phaser fire.
Brilliant line.
And then he goes into sort of tracker mode, but he ends up eating their dung and goes, tangy. It's just, oh.
He's still rocking this show. He's brilliant.
And it turns out that the Mugato are being kept captive by Ferengi with whips, a la that.
Your last outpost, yes.
Yeah. And one of them is wearing a Mugato coat thing.
Yes, he's the leader called Kink, which is a great name for a Ferengi. This is Tom Kenny returning to voice yet another Ferengi. He does sound like a Poundland Shimmerman, which I guess is what they were going for, but it just makes you want to add the real thing.
Mm. And it's all sort of, you know, you're doing the wrong thing, you're breaking the law, we've got to arrest you or whatever. And so one of the Ferengi fires a whip, but it gets the charge gets misdirected to the thing that controls all the gates, and all the alarms goes off, and then you've got a Mugato stampede. But while they're all stampeding, Boimler and Rutherford see Mariner, what looks like, stabbing Shax. They're like, shit, he actually is a Black Ops. So they want to run away from Mariner and towards the Mugato. Meanwhile, the guy who was going to be buying the horn.
Yeah, his name is, I took this up because I'm not sure it's used on screen. He's called Hyde, and he's voiced by Paul F. Tompkins, who also voices Maglimo, your favourite bird psychologist
guy.
Oh,
cool. He's escaping in the ship, but instead of saying he's escaping, he just says, leave me alone or whatever, and then they go and track him, and the ship falls apart. He's like, no, it's my ship. It's the best thing ever. And now, does she have a name? I think she's a lieutenant on the bridge in yellow who says it's the lowest tractor factor.
No, of course she doesn't have a name, but that is a great line, isn't it?
And then you have Boimler and Rutherford running away from the Mugato, and then they hide under a tree, very reminiscent of Fellowship of the Rings.
Yeah.
And then they sort of hands over their mouths and sort of pulled in closer by someone who calls himself Patengi.
Yes, he was voiced by Robert Gilbert, who was last heard voicing the Poundland Jason Statham crewman on the Titan.
Oh, right.
So he's doing a variety of slightly dubious British accents here. Unless he's supposed to be doing Australian, I couldn't quite tell.
I thought he was trying to pretend to be someone like Steve Irwin, who's Australian.
Yeah. Yeah, it's not great at accents.
No. Anyway, he says, you know, Patengi, no, don't you know me? I'm Patengi. 5 books. And he says, no, he's read 5 books, not written 5 books, and therefore thinks that he can sound like one of them badly. Gets eaten, purple blood everywhere, which is brilliant.
Child 2 was like, oh, I like this character. Then immediately he gets eaten. Like, no,
no, Patengi. And then Boimler, Rutherford, end up hiding in a log. And Mugato's quote, it's like, oh, no, they're going to eat us. And he's like, no, they're mating. It's like, oh. And it's like, what's he doing? Oh, no, if he's going to be a nightmare if he gets dominant. No, he's not getting dominant. I think he likes to watch.
Yeah. So last podcast, I always make a point of thanking anybody who retweets the tweet about us, our podcast. And one of those people is usually Lee. Now, Lee from the Black Dog podcast, when you retweet his podcast, he sends you a little picture, which is quite stupid. I thought I'd do it in return. So I did one from this episode, not from this episode, but the episodes we were covering last time. And he said, I don't mind as long as you don't send me an image of Mugato Freeway, log porn. And I'm thinking, what the hell? That's a weird thing to come up with. But of course, he'd seen this episode.
Yeah. Do that this time.
Yeah, I might be. I might have an image standing by.
And eventually they're able to escape from this log. And it's like, oh, you know, they're all shagged out. And Rutherford's like, that's gross, even the Watcher.
Yeah.
Oh. And then Mariner gets caught by a Ferengi trap.
Mm. We're caught in a trap. I can't walk out.
Because I love you.
Not sure, but that's better than the other option. So.
Yes, and she's not Black Ops. She just happened to have a lucky catch when they threw the tricorders at her before.
Yeah, and she'd actually made up the rumour herself as well, yeah. Which I quite like.
Yeah, so she gets caught by the Ferengi, and then you've got Boimler going, you know, we can't kick ass like Mariner does, but we can use our, and he touches his head and Rutherford goes, our skin? It's like, no, yeah. Our brains. Meanwhile, back on the Cerritos, Hyde, did you say his name was?
Mm-hmm.
Is scamming the Cerritos crew out of a shuttlecraft and yep. A whole load of stuff.
A U2-themed shuttlecraft.
Yes, the Joshua Tree. Is that the one that appeared on people's iPhones?
No, I think that was a later album that we got foisted with, yes.
And so he's scamming away. And then Boimler, on the planet Boimler and Rutherford appear, and it looks like you might think they make a weapon, but no, it's a projector. And they're explaining to the Ferengi how they make much more profit if it's a reserve rather than if they're poachers. And it becomes sort of, oh, you know, I can understand this. This is fair enough. So they end up reporting that, you know, these Ferengi are really eco-friendly. And this is while Captain's name escaped me. Freeman,
yeah.
Freeman is on the phone to someone. And they're like, oh, you know, you haven't encountered any ships, have you? Because, you know, there's this scam going on.
That's her Admiral husband.
So, you know, you haven't come across any of these scams. And she's like, no. And then so she then tractors the Joshua Tree with him in and says, you know, I should arrest you, but we can just pretend this never happened and you can just give everything back. So that gets resolved and basically all is well. But I kind of... And you end with them sort of shoveling dung out the way to make a gift shop. The Ferengi. So that... and all the Mugatus are happy.
Yep.
So it's good fun.
You've missed an entire plot out, unless I was sleeping through it. The whole Ta'ana business?
Oh, yeah. That's weird.
It's brilliant, because it's like, cats absolutely hate going to the vets. Where it turns out that Ta'ana's got a whole list of people that haven't had their medical... Including Stevens,
yes,
whose hip gives out on him because he's got bad bones.
Yeah, and that's because Tendy's passed him some milk to drink.
Yeah,
it's
fantastic. But anyway, also on the list is a mystery patient who turns out to be Ta'ana, who, of course, doesn't want any medical attention because she's a cat.
Yeah.
And then Tendy has to chase her all over the ship.
Oh,
and
she hides under things and scratches her face and all the rest of it. And then afterwards she's like, oh, it wasn't that bad. I don't know why I made
something
of it. Yeah.
Oh, and one of the patients isn't Kayshon. Kayshon is fighting Jet.
Yes.
And Jet's one of the patients and he's distracted by getting scanned and gets his light punched out by Kayshon, who's still not getting any lines. A boo.
No. But yes, Ta'ana just being a cat was great fun.
Oh, and it turns out Ta'ana's still got a thing for Shax as well.
Oh, yeah, he says, you know, you might have these side effects. I will heal you. I'm so ready to heal you. I'll heal you all night. Okay. Yeah, but cat bloody hates going to the vet.
Yeah, you can see where that was coming from.
Yeah.
But yeah, Shax eating poop was just brilliant.
Oh, horrible. Gross. Gross.
So it's a fun episode. I mean, I'd be back on side with Mariner at the end, given how sweet she'd been to Boimler and Rutherford, if she hadn't beaten the crap out of them at the start, which is a bit off-putting, but never mind. Other than that, there's lots going on, and it's good fun, and there's some really funny lines in it. I mean, Mugato's having sex. It's just brilliant.
Yeah. And their genitals are sensitive to phaser fire, I think. So, yeah, I really enjoyed it.
Good fun. All right, let's find out what other people thought. So we've heard from Doreen.
Hello. This time I'm going to try and get the feedback right and do two episodes, because unlike Purry, last week I only realised on the day you recorded, or the next day, that I'd only done one episode. So episode 4 of Lower Decks, I did enjoy it. The security... head of security and tracking the creatures wasn't too great, and it was definitely an adult episode with the creature who liked to watch the mating and various different bad words and so on. But Mariner wasn't too annoying in this one, and she was the one who got trapped in the trap, so that was quite good. And I also liked the very Star Trek way of getting the Ferengi to look after the creatures rather than hunt them. But in the middle of the episode, when Boimler and the cyborg man, I've forgotten his name, came in to do their presentation to the Ferengi, I thought they'd gotten completely confused about the backstories of the Ferengi, because they were making them out to be vampires and afraid of daylight. But it was quite funny. I was almost laughing at times. So I quite enjoyed this. It gets the Doreen seal of approval episode 4 does. Thank you. Bye-bye.
Bye. Thank you.
Thank you. Yeah, Mariner wasn't too annoying in this one. I mean, I know you didn't like the fact...
Other than the opening scene, yeah.
Yeah. And yes, it is an adult episode.
It is, yes. I thought that was something in that. Blimey. Mugato mating and all sorts. Yeah, now, and it was a very Star Trek solution.
Yeah.
I love the fact that they come in and it looks like they've built a bazooka or even a pipe bomb like Kirk builds in Arena. But, you know, it turns out to be a projector.
Yeah, I love that.
Because they're geeks. And Ferengi had an issue with light in the last outpost because they were constantly covering their eyes when the lightning hit. And so this is it's part of the joke is that these are last outpost Ferengi who then get won over on the basis they're given a better business proposition.
Yeah. And one of them actually says, of course I heard of Quark, doesn't he? So I quite like.
Thank you, Doreen.
Thank you. What did Sampo make of this?
Hey-o. Just watched Mugato Gumato, and here are some random thoughts. So, this was kind of a meh episode. I mean, the main narrative of Boimler and Rutherford thinking that Mariner's sort of secret agent, I mean, that fell flat to me. I mean, I don't know, just didn't find it too fun or even believable. I mean, the only laugh I got out of that whole thing was finding out that Starfleet lost a ship to lice. So that was fun. Mugatos, don't have much nostalgia for them. So that didn't. I had a lot more nostalgia for the last outpost style Ferengi with their whips and all that. I mean, okay, they were pretty fun, I think. Of course, Rutherford and Boimler are into complex board games, and you know, I am too. I mean, you know, I like board games that last hours, and they have a 100-page manual that you need to read. It sort of paid off in the end. I like the solution that they got the Ferengi to stand down by offering them profit margins in the long term. That was actually quite Star Trek-y. What else? Okay. Low-hanging fruit, but whenever Dr. Tiana is doing cat things, it just makes me laugh. Very simple, but... And I think they were taking the smuttiness to a whole new level here. And I was sometimes... I mean, I watch this. Sometimes the kids wander into the room and look at it for a while and then just walk off. So when... two Mugatos were going at it and the third one was watching. I was especially glad that none of the kids were in the room at that point. And what else? Okay, there's a subplot with the guy whose ship was destroyed by the tractor beam. I mean, I found the idea pretty funny, especially when the science officer was like, the tractor beam was on the lowest setting. So, I mean... I found that funny, but it actually became a bit less funny when we actually found out it was just a ruse. And, you know, Captain Mariner, I mean, why did he give him all of his memorabilia? I mean, that was taking it a bit too far. I mean, okay, they lose shuttles all the time, so giving a shuttle away, that's fine. But, you know, giving his limited edition Gorn figurine, that's taking it too far. But no, I mean, it was... wasn't really my favorite. I did enjoy it more than the first episode, but still, the previous two were a lot better. So clearly, quite a lot of fluctuation in quality here. Let's see if the next one's better.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Sorry, you didn't enjoy this one as much. I thought it was good fun.
Yes. The secret agent stuff. I did one. I found it believable enough.
Yes, just about.
Just about. Yeah, you are right. It is going too far to get rid of your limited edition Gorn figure. I mean, that I guess mm-hmm. that tips the scales, doesn't it? It makes it unbelievable that she gave that away.
Yeah. But yes, Tana doing cat things is always brilliant. So.
Yes.
We have heard from the Llama God.
Numbers, Lux, Scott Dick, Figures here, Noi, Kirk Jake. Let's call the whole thing off. Now, this is something we return to form with this pair of episodes. They're much more entertaining and they've got a lot less to complain about than I do about the previous episodes. And I'll start by saying apologies if I don't sound quite up to scratch this week, but I have been fighting off a cold the last few days, which the scrap letter has passed on to both Joe and myself. Ah, the joys of parenthood. If only we lived in a world where the common cold had been eradicated, just like in Starfleet. But oh well, here we are. But yes, this is a brilliant episode. It's great to see the Mugato back, and in a way, it feels very much like Next Generation. I love the whole idea of the Diplomath board game. I mean, that's very Star Trek Next Generation, isn't it? I mean, I know that there's the whole poker night thing that the crew had going on, but Diplomath, this really seems like this is what the crew should have been playing. A game where you win by negotiating to a standstill? Yeah, that is so Next Generation, it's unreal. So yeah, I really love that idea. And the fact that it becomes key to the episode, that's great. The fact that that's carried through, it's not just a one-off joke. The fact that it's the key to the episodes, yeah, I really like that as well. It's also nice to see the Ferengi in a kind of weird hybrid between the sort of slavers that we see them as when we first meet them in The Last Outpost and the more typical businessmen kind of role that we've seen them in since Deep Space Nine. So yeah, it's just nice to see this. And obviously, the thing, you're going to have to get their resources from somewhere, so it makes sense that they have operations like this. So yeah, and obviously it's Mugato. This is not something we'd actually see in live action, is it? So yeah, it was great to meet them again here. The whole gag about Mariner having her secret special pass with Black Ops, and it turns out that it's something she's made up. Yeah, that's a good gag. That's exactly the sort of thing that she would do. So it's really in keeping with her character. And the fact that it's used to just solidify her friendship with Boimler and Rutherford, yeah, that's a nice use of it as well. It's not, again, it's not just a throwaway gag, it's something that makes sense. But that said, when it comes to throwaway gags, this Spark the Soil Engines have some great ones as well. There's the whole line, we have special powers, yes, our skins, no, our brains, yes, our brains, which are inside our skin. Yeah, I love that. And also the revelation that Mugato genitals are sensitive to phaser fire, which is much like my own, really. Not that I've ever had an incident with phaser fire, my genitals, you understand, that's all just hearsay, but anyway, I thought that was striking from the Admiral's log. Anyway, moving on. And the other storyline with Tendi having to do surprise physicals on the crew, that's just a bit of fun, isn't it? I like to see her asserting herself, becoming a bit stronger as a character, and also just with some great setup of gags. The best one, of course, being that it's Tiana herself that, like every good cat, doesn't want to go to the vet. So yeah, that was great. And of course, at the very end, discovering that it wasn't that bad in the end. Yeah, that's something that rings very true as a previous cat owner and a parent. Yeah, so the one curious thing I saw about this episode, though, was the Cardassians that have a certain response when they see the Mugato, their necks flare up. Now, is that the Cardassian neck trick that we hear all about, that, you know, Odo is supposed to be very good at performing? Is that what Cardassians actually do when threatened? Is it a thing, or is this just something they've done for the cartoon? But yeah, this was a fun little episode. I like the resolution. And yeah, it just moved along nicely and was very entertaining. So yeah, more of this, please. On to the next one.
Aha, those weren't Cardassians.
No, they were Denobulans.
Denobulans who do indeed do that weird puff-up face thing. Yes. Yep.
And yes, it's some great one-liners in here. And yeah, Cat doesn't want to go to the vet.
Yeah, that is brilliant.
Yes.
Basically, this season, anything to Anna-related or Shax-related, and I'm in.
Yeah. Thank you, sir.
Thank you all. And hope you're feeling better soon.
Yes. What did Parry make of this?
Hello, Orgs. Parry here to talk about Mugato Gumato. And I quite enjoyed this. A bit of a weird thing. Was this a Mariner Light episode? Because she wasn't in it too much. I mean, her presence was kind of there. She was mentioned a lot, but actual Mariner herself. It makes me wonder if they are trying to give the other members of the cast a bit more screen time. So we had basically two plots running here. The first is Mariner, Boimler, Rutherford, and a bunch of the rest of the crew, including Shax, are down hunting Mugatos because there's Mugatos on a planet there's not meant to be, and it's a Ferengi plot for selling a Mugato horn, which I thought was quite fun. Again, just you know, it's again taking some fun out of a rather daft TOS monster, and you know, sort of putting some stuff around it. That was all quite fun. And again, the Ferengi being a little bit threatening, you know, the Mugato getting out and causing all sorts. And the idea of the barman scaring Rutherford and Boimler into thinking that Mariner could be a kind of dangerous special forces person who might kick in, you know, that was all kind of fun. And it's nice to, it's actually quite nice. Again, we had Tendi and Mariner teamed up last time, and it's actually really nice to see Rutherford and Boimler again. They are trying out the different pairings, and I think it worked quite well. I liked their board game, which was all about compromise, very Federation. I like it. We also had the B plot of Tendi having to scan everyone's medical thing, and you know, her sort of trying to be more assertive with it. And again, that was fun. You know, we got to see again Jet got punched in the face by Kayshawn. He appears to be making little guest appearances, and just indeed the way she kind of appeared in some really unlikely ways, you're like on the hang glider and whatnot. And I mean, I found out one of the things in this series, it turns out I like it whenever Dr. Ta'ana does cat stuff. So the whole thing of Tendi trying to chase her for her medical, and you know, her doing the things like hiding under the shuttle, and you know, the yowling and scratching, that was all really good fun. And indeed Tendi breaking her own arm in order to get the scan was really quite funny. The bit probably which nearly lost me, one of the things, my kids have never been too into watching too much telly, or at least not as they got older. They tend to apparently watch all those YouTubes. So as a result, I, as a parent, have managed to avoid that horrible period where you're watching a David Attenborough documentary and you get the, you know, the, oh yes, here comes the noble rhinoceros about to mount the female, and you basically have to sit in a room with your family while rhinoceroses hump and grunt at each other. Fortunately, even though I've missed out on that lovely bit of family building, Lower Decks managed to help me because my son was watching his YouTubers on the iPad as we got the Mugato humping scene. So that was definitely a thing. I found that there is an upper limit as to how much Mugato sex I can have, and this episode exceeded it. So we've all learned something about ourselves. But overall, I think this was quite a good laugh. Again, possibly taking a couple of wee things, you know, I liked the joke of the throwback Last Outpost Ferengi. And, you know, the sort of haven't you heard of Quark, you know, that Ferengi are better now. I like kind of those references, but I mean, for those who get annoyed about it being dropping references every 5 minutes, it was actually not too reference heavy. And I like the way the solution was through diplomacy and bargaining, and you know, they come in with what looks like the Gorn cannon, and it turns out to be a PowerPoint presenter, and basically, you know, it turns into a compromise. So yeah, I found that really good fun. So yeah, overall, a good solid episode, and I'd really like to see more of them looking at some of the other characters. I think this is definitely going to be fun if they're going to do a bit more of this. So I'll be back in a bit to talk about the next episode, whose title at time of recording is still TBA, unless the title is actually TBA. I suppose we'll find out, but until then, bye for now.
Bye. Yes, we'll find out if Amory's prediction of the title turns out to be right or not.
What did I predict? I don't remember.
I'll be reminding you about that shortly.
Oh.
But you're right, this one was reference light.
Yeah.
And I think it actually benefited from that. Yeah. You know, some of the references work, but sometimes they do overdo it, yeah.
But also, it's good to look more at the other characters, which this episode does, doesn't
yep,
it?
Yeah, it's Marina Light as well, which is, I'm afraid to say, an always a good thing.
Yeah, and sorry that there was, although you had avoided humping rhinos with David Attenborough, you had too much from Gartu sex.
For me, that's the even more embarrassing bit was the one who watched.
Yes.
That really dropped it to greater depths.
Yeah, that was funny though.
Yeah, a great episode. Excellent.
Yes.
Cool. Okay, so we move on to the episode. It is not called My Bum is a Peach.
Why did I
How
say
How dare you forget that? You were very, very drunk.
Was I?
Yes.
Oh. But why did I say that?
You were drunk. That's why you said that.
What was the context?
Well, we didn't know the name of the episode. It was TBA at the time. And you said, well, I think it's going to be called My Bum is a Peach. In much that tone of voice.
Oh, sorry. Probably I'd had a few.
No money won there, I'm afraid to say, because it's called An Embarrassment of Dooplers.
Right.
Well, who could have guessed that? Absolutely nobody. Anyway.
I think my episode title's better.
Well, who knows? Maybe another episode. You do get some sort of, you know, not quite bonus points, but consolation points if a later episode is called My Bum is a Peach. I still don't think so. Even if we started a writing campaign, I'm not sure it's going to happen.
I'd totally forgotten that.
Captain's log. Stardate 58053.9. The Cerritos is escorting a Doopler emissary to Starbase 25 for trade negotiations. Dooplers are a species which involuntarily duplicate as an emotional defense mechanism. We've been walking on eggshells the entire trip.
So we have no teaser, which is a bit weird. Possibly the episode overran or something, I don't know. The Cerritos is transporting a Doopler ambassador, a species that duplicates as an emotional defense mechanism, which is stressing out the senior officers. This particular Dupla is voiced by Richard Kind, who was in Argo. He's a regular on Sesame Street.
Mm.
And the starbase they're heading for is also the location for a conference of senior officers, followed by a massive party at which Freeman will be the only California-class captain present. Ah, apparently only crew from capital ships normally get an invite. And suddenly, apparently, we get the explanation for this dual uniform thing, because some ships are capital ships and they get Deep Space Nine uniforms, and other ships, like the Cerritos, are less important and they get a completely different uniform. Yeah. So we've got a class system now in Starfleet. Okay. And see the recent Great Derelict on the McKee for more on this, by the way. But yeah, this is odd. It's like, why would you introduce this? Because it wasn't in the original...
No.
Any original Trek series. So yeah, I'm very puzzled by this. But anyway, since the Titan is at the other end of the quadrant, Mariner realises Boimler composes his clone and get in with her as his plus one. I'm surprised you want to hang out with the great and the good, really. That's not really her style. But anyway, Tenney and Rutherford are building a model Cerritos, which floats and everything. It even comes with tiny versions of the crew.
I love that. And the tiny Boimler and the tiny Mariner are fighting.
Bossing him around. They manage to accidentally phaser someone with it.
I like that.
And their plotline is about Rutherford feeling frustrated that he's lost so much memory, basically. Starbase 25 turns out to be a beautiful variant on the old mushroom design.
Lovely.
Although we've added external docking for larger ships, which is cool.
Yep.
Various assorted ships there. There's one of the medical type ships that we get from the end of Next Generation.
Oh, the bollock. Design.
Yes, that's right.
I can't remember what it's supposed to be called. I just called it the bollock.
And there's the Andorian ship that looks rather like the Galactica as well, that's docked there as well. And we see Andorians in the station, so that makes sense. They're hailed by an unnamed captain. Freeman proceeds to talk about how stressful carrying the Dooplers has been, not realising that he's on the bridge, leading to multiple duplications and them getting banned from docking. Boimler is considering wearing a scant, which would have been cool, but Mariner says that no one wears them anymore. Aboo!
No!
They end up going for dress uniform instead, which is a variation on the white ones from Insurrection.
Yeah, I don't like them.
I don't dislike them. She realises the chaos on the bridge means no one will spot her overriding the transporter, which is a good bit of getting around how to sneak off the ship with no one realising. Nice one. We find out that Mariner used to live on Starbase 25. Just how old is she supposed to be?
Yeah.
And there's a branch of quarks there, which is cool.
Yep.
A bearded Tellarite spots them and recognises Mariner, reporting to a Miserian called Melvis.
Didn't we have them in, was it Deep Space Nine or Next Gen or both?
Next Gen, Season 3. Allegiance. They're the ones who were famous for giving in to everybody.
Yeah, I thought that. Yeah,
surrendering to any invader. Yes. So just one appearance in Next Generation, but you know, this is written by someone who knows his Star Trek, particularly his Next Generation. So yeah. It's voiced by Tom Kenny again. He calls her Becky, which is quite nice, and accuses her of stranding him on Sati Alpha 4, which is apparently much worse than Sati Alpha 5. But I thought there was life there, she said.
That's brilliant.
It's a shame they didn't have a bit of the Star Trek II music in the background there, but anyway. He offers to tell them where the secret party is happening if they'll move some merchandise for him. And that supposedly turns out to be data bubble baths.
Oh, brilliant.
With a couple of laws thrown in. Also, illegal weapons, we find out later, as Malvis betrays them. Curse you for your inevitable betrayal. Freeman decides silence might be the best option when it comes to Dooplers, but they think she's giving him the silent treatment, so that's quite good. Then we get quite an impressive car chase, actually.
Yes, I like it.
A station security pursuing Mariner and Boimler.
And they're in the thing, buggy things, that like the one in Nemesis.
Yes, I think that's what they're based on. They take a trip through a casino with Klingons playing Dabo. A barber's complete with Bolian.
Yeah, they've crashed through for Zad for Jazzles.
A close shot with those tubes of material from our encounter at Farpoint. They nearly run over a Lurian and someone in a Pike-style wheelchair.
Mm.
And then they hit a food store for Antedian fish people from Manhunt.
Yes.
Don't call us people. They go through a Vulcan ship and then into a massive aviary, nearly killing a groundskeeper who's disappointed not to die.
Yeah.
It's great fun. I love this stuff. Mariner threatens Malvis into telling them where the party is, but the bouncer won't let her into the ballroom. He's an insectoid species that was featured in the animated series. Boimler and Mariner have an argument about him abandoning her for the Titan, and he goes in without her. The ballroom is very Vegas with cheesy music playing.
Yep. Boimler's... I'm surprised there isn't some sort of alien or Starfleet Tom Jones.
Yes. Boimler spots Captain Shelby and her number one, who is based on the original design for Saru in Discovery before they realise that all those eyes would have been a nightmare to animate in live action. There's also a captain called Exley, who's tiny and sits on his number one shoulder. Turns out old Rutherford never finished his model, as it was the excuse Tandy and he had to hang out with one another, which seems a bit bizarre, but there we go.
Well, it was more that nobody else wanted to do that as well, so they got to just be the two of them.
Just the two of us. We can make it if we try.
Yeah, I'm sure they could have done that anyway. But anyway, they escape the Dooplers by ejecting these models' tiny warp core and blasting open a panel with it. It's like, oh, hot.
Yes.
And there's a speeded up countdown when they eject it. I like that.
Cool. And I love the speeded up, the voice as well. Yeah. It's like a chipmunk.
Yeah. Boimler leaves the party as it's no fun without Mariner, despite the non-stop sliders, whatever the hell they are. Answers on a postcard, because Google just showed me pictures of sandals, which I can't help feeling they can't be. He goes to the bar that Mariner's in and apologises to her for not realising she had feelings. Freeman tells the Dooplers off for being snivelling babies, which results in them recombining, which is a bit bizarre, but there you go, that leads to a great Shax line.
Your paw is weak, and it disgusts me!
I don't even know what that is, but I don't like your toe!
Sliders.
Oh, it's a cocktail. Well done.
Rye, Kahlua, and milk.
Well, I bet Andy would like that. He likes his White Russians, doesn't he? So
yeah.
Oh.
They're green.
That can't be right. Anyway. Anna swears at them to get them to recombine, which is cool.
Yes.
The bartender informs Marion and Boimler that Spock and Kirk drank at her bar, which is a large model of the Phoenix for some reason. And also that, what's it was called from the Doomsday Weapon?
Yes.
That big worm-eaty thing. Yeah. The bouncer won't let Freeman and the senior officers in either, and she's outraged to hear O'Connor has been let in.
Oh,
wow,
yeah.
Puntastic there.
Yeah, yeah.
Marin invites her mum and co to join her in what is now being called Kirk's Bar, which is nice. Dooplers turns up, and the captain gets him beamed to the Starfleet party with predictable consequences. Freeman decides the only people she wants to hang out with are in Kirk's bar, and Boimler is duped into being Mariner's number one and is told he has to grow a beard.
I like that. Yeah.
It's all right. I mean, the Dooplers stuff is a bit stupid, to be honest, but I guess that works in cartoon Trek land. It wouldn't work in live action, obviously.
No.
And there's plenty of heart with the character interactions, which is, you know, when the show gets things right, that's what it's going for, is the heart side of things rather than the Mariner kit to everybody.
But it's also got an awesome car chase in it.
Yeah.
And that's good.
That's fun, yeah.
But I like the idea as well that Kirk and Spock got kicked out of the, or didn't make the big party.
Somebody did a really nice picture, which was the animated series Kirk and Spock in that bar.
Yeah.
Which is kind of cute, but there you go, it wasn't. I was kind of expecting to see it because I'd seen it before I saw this episode.
Yeah.
I was kind of expecting to see it. I was kind of disappointed when it wasn't there.
The voice of the lovely purple bartender reminded me of Daria.
Oh, yeah.
I couldn't help thinking of her while the bartender was speaking.
Oh, right.
So I just decided that, I don't know whether she has a name other than bartender, but in my brain, she's bartender Daria.
I have a feeling they don't have an episode. Let me have a look.
Embarrassment of Dooplers.
Embarrassment, yes. Not My Bum is a Peach. I'm not going to search memory alpha for My Bum is a Peach. But if somebody puts that entry in, I'll give them. I will give them money.
I can't believe I said that.
Jennifer Lewis is bartender. Apparently she was in a Star Trek audio novel called Captain Sulu Adventures. Mm. She's in the Princess and the Frog.
Okay.
She was in the recent Addams Family.
Right.
Is that an animated one? Cars 3. Yeah, there's a lot of animation stuff, basically. She was in Mystery Men, which we've seen. She was in Sister Act.
Okay.
Let's find out what other people thought.
What did Dory make of this one?
An Embarrassment of Dooplers was less good than the last episode. It was kind of half and half. I don't know if the race was called Dooplers, but... I thought they were a bit like the new Tribbles. So all that sort of, well, hilarity around the doubling of character was quite funny. And then them more or less having to make him more upset and angry to make him recombine was really quite funny. But Mariner was her blooming old, really annoying self. So that just took all enjoyment out of the episode. If she wasn't in it and all her nonsense, I would have laughed at a good number of things. But Mariner totally ruined it for me. So thank you for the podcast. And I'm sure I will enjoy your coverage of the episode a lot more than I enjoyed the actual episode. So thank you in advance. Look after yourself. Bye.
Yeah, I mean, I generally find Marin irritating. I think she was quite so bad in this episode, but yeah, she can take the fun out of the episode sometimes.
Yeah. And I think as well, if you don't like a character, if that feeling is strong, then even if the episode's good, it can be really hard to like it.
Mm.
There have been times when I've really taken against a character in something and I haven't bothered watching the rest of whatever the series is just because there's no point, because I just spend the entire time being really fucked off. Hence, I didn't watch Game of Thrones because there was... Is it Jeffrey? I don't know. Some twat. And
I think Jeffrey was in Rainbow, so that's not him.
Oh, okay. Anyway, there was a twat who wasn't dead soon enough, so I didn't watch. But I don't personally find Mariner that annoying, but in terms of the concept of finding a character so annoying, yep, it ruins your enjoyment, totally get it.
But yeah, the Dooplers were a bit triple-like, you're right. That's, yes! Similar sort of idea and similarly amusing.
Yes. Less furry.
Well, quite. We've also heard from Sampo on this one.
And I just watched An Embarrassment of Dooplers, which, okay, it was better than the last one. Not as good as the few before that, but again, upward spiral. So reminded me a lot of the Short Trek with the tribbles, but I mean, I think the Duplo thing was maybe the least interesting thing about it. I liked Tendi and Rutherford doing the little model ship and Deep Space Nine at the end of the episode. And they keep teasing us with the quarks and all of that. I mean, they've got to bring someone from Deep Space Nine this season, don't they? Don't they? What else? Okay, so is Shax now the chief of security? They still haven't addressed it. I mean, they really should address it. But otherwise... I think the episode was enjoyable. I mean, the chase scene was a bit long, but otherwise it was... What did I actually like? I mean, now that I'm supposed to explain why I actually liked it, that's a good question. I mean, I liked the banter between Mariner and Boimler, although, I mean, suddenly Boimler is... missing the Titan. I mean, even though he wanted away from there, or did he? Okay, that's again a bit unclear. But good that they got a bit closure out of it. And okay, maybe the fact that the bar was one where Kirk and Spock had been, that was a bit on the nose. Okay, now that I'm actually talking about it, it's it actually sounds like I didn't like the episode that much. But I actually did. I mean, 24 minutes just sort of flew by. I liked it, but it's one that I really haven't got very much to say about. So, so I guess better not waste any more time then. So let's wait for the next one. Bye.
Bye there, thank you. Yes, there's a lot of Deep Space Nine teasing going on, yeah, isn't there? I hope this is building up to something at the end of the season. That would be really, really cool.
Yeah, because you get the Deep Space Nine model.
Yeah.
Which is
produced by Quark as well.
Yeah, I like that. I like that.
He's got quite the business empire now, hasn't he?
Yeah.
I like it. Shax is definitely head of security. He's in all the senior meetings now, and he's, it's him that beams down to go to the party. It's Kayshon who's been kind of sort of dropped into a non-speaking part now, which is a bit odd.
Yeah. Hope he gets some more lines and can do some more stuff.
But yes, I think Boimler liked aspects of being on the Titan. Like, you know, he mentions that, you know, the replicated stuff was better, even the water.
Yeah.
What he didn't like, I think, was the peril and, you know, being in danger all the time, basically, so...
But this is a fun episode, I likes. What about the Llama God? What do you make of this?
Logos log, supplemental. In the event of air water landing, my ass can be used as a flotation device. Yeah, this is another great, really fun episode with an interesting little concept as well. We've got the Dooplers. Yes, the Dooplers. This is something that, again, you couldn't really do outside of animation, or at least not with a lot of expensive CGI. So, yeah, this is really something that animation was made for with Trek. And, yeah, whilst it is basically a play on the Tribbles, you've got a character that reproduces quite rapidly, it's also different enough, and the circumstances under which the reproduction, such as it is, happens are different enough that, it's a sound little science fiction concept. It's also ridiculous. It makes not a lot of sense at all. But, yeah, whatever. It's very Lower Decks, isn't it? So it fits in perfectly. And yeah, I really loved it. The whole story of the Dooplers on the ship and how Captain Freeman is able to control the situation by basically being as unstarfleet as possible about it. Yeah, I really like that. Because as well as being, you know, not particularly starfleet, it is also very starfleet in that they're using their brains to solve the situation and not just their fists. So yeah, I kind of appreciated that. And it also gave us a little subplot with Rutherford and Tendi trapped while they're trying to build their little model ship. Again, this is something very Star Trek, isn't it? And how often do we see captains of ships with their own little model ships? I'm looking at you, Bill Adama. But the fact that this is actually a working replica as well, and I absolutely love the gag with a self-destruct with actually tiny keys to unlock the warp core and a squeaky little computer voice. That was hilarious. I love that. The other subplot with Marin and Boimler desperately trying to get into the party but being sidetracked with jobs to do to basically clear up Mariner's past. Yeah, it was a slight plot, I guess, but it led to a lot of cool gags. I mean, I really liked the whole data bubble bath thing. Car chase was ridiculous. And yeah, the solution when they get locked out of the party, as is Captain Freeman, and they send the Dooplers in instead. Yeah, I love that. It was great. We also got to see Captain Shelby. Captain Shelby, that's great. She's actually gone far. So that's good. That's good to see. And it does nicely lampoon just how up themselves Starfleet are. The bar that they find themselves in at the end is also great, with just so many little callbacks on the wall, like with the picture of Balok and so many other things on the wall. It's just wonderful. Love that. A lot to see in that episode. And to be honest, I think I missed a lot of things on the station itself as well. I mean, I saw the Quarks, obviously, but there was so much in the background that at some point I'll have to go back and review it frame by frame, if owners of work being ill at the moment. But yeah. Anyway, so yeah, this was a good, fun episode that just rattled along nicely. And what's really notable about it is that it gets all the characters back into a position where everyone's happy and comfortable with just as we reach the midpoint of the season, which lays the foundations nicely for whatever's going to happen towards the latter half of the season, which hopefully will be as satisfying as the end of last season. So yeah, we'll see about that. So in all, yeah, a very good couple of episodes, and I'm very pleased about these. And since you've already done an episode on the future of Star Trek, I just quickly wanted to mention my own thoughts on future Treks, the things that we saw from the recent Star Trek day. So in terms of what's coming up, yeah, Prodigy, that looks fun. I'm not entirely sure it's completely going to be for me. It's for kids, and that's great, that's fine, because Star Trek for kids is a fantastic idea. I like this very much. It very much looks like it's going to be of a style that I think kids will like. I think it's kind of in a How to Train Your Dragon sort of style, and it's a very similar style to the upcoming Master of the Universe cartoon for kids. Not the Revelations, Kevin Smith one, there's another one, and that starts airing the day you're recording this, actually. So yeah, this could work really well. And the whole idea that it's about some kids trying to escape to freedom, and that it's Starfleet's going to show them the way, yeah, this has the potential to be a good series, and the kids could learn a lot from it. On the flip side, I'm still not sure what to make of Picard. I'm still furious with Picard because of what they did in that final episode. That's just still rankles so much that, I mean, I'm going to watch Picard, obviously, but they've got a lot of work to do there to get me back on side. Yeah, there's a gag of Q doing the trial, and I'm totally there with Anne-Marie. I hate parallel universe stories, but if it's going to tell us something about the characters, if they're going to learn or grow somehow, then this could be good, just as long as they do actually learn and grow, and there isn't the big fucking cop-out like they gave us at the end of season one of Picard. Yeah, that's really what they need to do here. They actually need to have some consequence and not just be reset at the end, or something, don't do it again. And whilst it might be fun that they're going back into the past, i.e. to modern day Earth, it's been kind of done with Voyage Home, and it's going to suffer a lot in being compared with that story. So hopefully they've got more than a few gags, and hopefully it'll pay off. But yeah, as I say, I'm going to try and be positive about it, but they've got a lot of work to do. And Strange New Worlds, yeah, we didn't see a lot about that. We haven't learned a lot about it yet, apart from the fact they've got new uniforms, which I was a bit iffy about to begin with, although the colours are still the same. The fact they've gone a lot more casual, yeah, I guess that brings them more in line with the original series Star Trek, but having seen their much more formal uniforms that they'd used on Discovery, yeah, it just seems a bit weird. But yeah, I think they're going to grow on me, and they'll be a lot more fun Hunt cosplay, definitely. So, yeah, I'm looking forward to this, and I'm really glad that they've cast Uhura and some other characters. I'm slightly disappointed they haven't got Rebecca Romijn playing both Number One and Nurse Chapel, because that would have been a great opportunity for a bit of a gag there. But yeah, I'm glad they've got all those characters on board. I'm really looking forward to this series. My main concern, really, is that can they resist the urge to do an overarching arc? Because that's just the thing that's done. Are they really going to be able to resist it? So, fingers crossed. And are they going to be able to resist the urge to show us Lieutenant Kirk on the Farragut in the event that brings him his first captaincy? So, yeah, can they resist that? Can they resist giving us a Kirk? I really don't think they're going to be able to do that. But let's hope that if they do, that they don't do it too soon. And when they do it, they don't make it this mythic thing that J.J. Abrams' films made. It's just a thing, just a particularly good captain that we meet. So, yeah, we'll see. So, yeah, there's a lot to look forward to, not least of which is the next few episodes of Lower Decks, based on these past two episodes. So, as ever, I'm looking forward to finding out what everyone else made of all of this. I hope everyone's still doing well as the summer comes to an end. And until next time, glory to you, Nick Guest!
Thank you, sir.
Thank you. So he thinks that Firestarter looks fun.
Yeah. I'm pretty sure it's not for me, but hey, I've said that sort of thing in the past and then found out otherwise. But on the basis that we can't actually see it without forking out lots more money for Sky, it's not happening.
No.
But yes, that's a reference to our coming attractions podcast we did recently with Andy. The more uniforms, I'm afraid, is very, very predictable, because that's how they make their monies these days.
Yeah.
But it will be, like he says, interesting to see if they can resist the arc, and indeed resist the Kirk as well. Yeah. Blimey. Yeah, there's a thought. But yes, in terms of the Dooplers, they I think it was a good Starfleet solution to the situation.
Yeah.
And it's daft, but it is a solution that works logically in terms of what is, after all, a very illogical creature. So.
Yes. Although the look reminded me of that Doctor Who twat, Ian Levine.
Oh my gosh, Mini Levine, blimey. Yes, I can see why you're saying that, yeah. Well, they would have got a lot more annoying a lot more quickly.
Yeah. But I would have had a lot of fun telling him to shut the fuck up.
Indeed. Anyway, let's find out what Puri made of this one.
Hello, Orcs. Puri here to talk about An Embarrassment of Dooplers. Arguably a better title than TBA, but who am I to judge? This is much more, and for a series that's not got particularly a large amount of episodes, this is very traditional Lower Decks fare, in that we have two main plots running, technically a third. You could argue that you've got your joint A plots, one with Boimler and Mariner, and one with Rutherford and Tendi. And then you've got kind of the main, effectively the C plot, but what's actually going on with the ship going on in the background to these plots and occasional input from the crew. The Doopler, it was okay. I thought you're sort of white, again, that I think that's a voice actor who does a lot, but that whiny voice and, you know, the duplicating every time it was socially awkward, that was kind of a concept. It was enough to keep the episode rolling, but I'm glad we didn't spend too long with it. In fact, what I found more interesting was this concept of the pecking order in Starfleet ships. So obviously our plot with Mariner and Boimler is that they're going to crash a party because Boimler composes his transporter duplicate on this station, which of course Mariner worked at. And I actually like the fact that, again, there's some call out, you know, oh yeah, I worked here for a bit. Oh, of course you did. I thought that was interesting. And in fact, one of the things I liked about this was kind of a lot of the aftermath of the end of last season finally coming out. So for example, you have Rutherford being annoyed that he's lost a year of his life, and he's thinking that effectively there was a better version of him out there. And that's, you know, considering it was all played for laughs, that was actually quite a deep thing. Similarly, you have Mariner is still annoyed with Boimler for leaving and for going. And I think one of the themes, it's not been subtle, it's been fairly on the nose, is that Mariner does worry about abandonment by her peers. I think we seem to think that she likes being of this lower rank, and friends above her have constantly gone for promotion and that sort of thing, why she got so annoyed with Boimler, and why she does keep people at arm's length. So I suppose you could call that character development, as much as we have any. More so actually with Boimler is the fact that he's putting up with a lot less of Mariner's crap, which is interesting. But we had a fun chase. The chase maybe went on a bit long. I thought it was a bit like one of those Family Guy chicken fights. Went on a bit long, but I did like a lot of the visual gags. Like I say, they are making this series for YouTubers to show stills of, to say, look, did you see this thing in the background that was in the background of an episode of the animated series for 20 seconds? Haha, did you? We did. Yeah, because you've got time to sit and parse through this thing frame by frame. Some of us have jobs. Yeah, there's that. I mean, I like the Rutherford and Tendy one. I did like, although again, the plot could technically have been solved by Tendy explaining this to Rutherford at the beginning of the episode. He's worried about why their model of the Cerritos, and I love the fact that they're making a model of the Cerritos on the Cerritos, and that it had the detail of a tiny mariner. And in fact, all the tiny details in the models I loved. I loved when they had to jettison a warp core. They had to open a little hatch with tweezers and turn a dial to jettison the core. That's just I'm possibly feel seen by it, but I loved that. And yeah, again, the Rutherford Tendy stuff is always just lovely. I like the idea that, yeah, why do we build models? We build models because if we do it, no one comes and talks to us. I like stuff like that. So yeah, overall, I like this idea of the pecking order of ships. You know, the fact that, yes, no matter what the Cerritos does, it's always a lower grade ship, and everyone on it's always going to be effectively second class. Yes, we did get to see a Captain Shelby and whatnot. That was all lovely, and O'Kana again, but just that, yes, the crew of the Cerritos will always be, and indeed probably some of the other ones like the Parliament class, will always be kind of second fiddle because they do all the support stuff, and so they never get invited to the cool parties. And I actually like the idea that they all ended up in a pub together. It's just, like I say, that stuff I find nice. So all that remains for me to say is do keep up the good work. I always enjoy the podcast, and I hope to be back to the next ones. But until then, bye for now.
Bye. I was just reflecting. I mean, I don't think there was like a class system in Starfleet before, except that the only exception, of course, is the flagship has always had this certain special something if you served on the Enterprise. Ooh.
Yeah.
So I suppose it's kind of an extension of that to more ships. But yeah, it still doesn't really work for me, I'm afraid to say. And I certainly don't think they should have different uniforms. That's madness.
But I kind of get where they're coming from with the party thing, because it's a bit like at the Oscars, it's all the actors, isn't it? The people in front of the camera,
and
maybe the directors. And the people who win for like hair and makeup, they don't get to go to the big parties, do they?
If with that it was just senior officers invited, then that would very much match what we've seen in Star Trek before. It's still not right.
No, but it would match what we've seen before.
I just don't understand this sort of... Yeah, there weren't different classes of ship being more impressive than others before. It was just that the Enterprise was a particularly prestigious ship because it was the flagship, which is still wrong, but it was there in the original series, and if they carried that on, fair enough. But anyway, yes, I know what you mean about the freeze frames. So, like, you know, in our case, of course, hours before you get to watch the episode, because it airs in the United States beforehand, you've got these people who've been sat there doing all this freeze-framing business, and you wonder, when do you have time to do this? I mean, the person who literally, there's, you know, at one point in the car chase, they nearly hit two people with a load of clothing on a rail.
Yeah.
I don't know if you noticed. And it's got a sign above it in Bajoran, and this person translated the Bajoran. And I wouldn't mind, but when they translated it, it was just like clothes sale or something like that. So it wasn't even worth translating in the first place. It's like, really? Really? But anyway.
Well, the only thing I would say is that some of the people who do that sort of stuff are insomniacs.
Well, yes, I suppose that would give you something to do. True.
No, but if you can't sleep and if you would otherwise just lie there worrying and stressing.
There are worse things to do
stressing.
If you can't sleep. Yes, very
good. Yeah.
Well, I do think they are getting Boimler a lot better in this. That's a really good sentence, isn't it? Boimler is a lot more likable.
He's less of an arse.
Yes, and he's standing up for himself. So I appreciate that. It's really only Mariner they need to work on a bit more, I think, to take some of the edges off.
And sometimes she's all right.
Hmm. Yeah, by the end of the last season, I was liking her.
Yeah.
But then at the beginning of this season, she then took a few steps back again, and it's like, come on.
Yeah.
She's the main character. She needs to be more likeable than this.
Yes. But I think I prefer it when there isn't really a main character. I think of it as having four main characters.
I still kind of feel like she's presented as the main character just because possibly her mom's the captain, and the way the initial setup happened, it seemed to be revolving around her and to a lesser extent Boimler. But yeah, who knows? By the end of the season, I'm sure I'll be loving her again. Right, shall we find out what the next episode titles are going to be?
Is one of them my bomb is a peach?
Let's see. Oh, bated breath, bated breath. We've got the spy Humungous.
Fnar.
Fnar, yes. Sounds like a Mad Max thing, that. And my bum is... No, it isn't, I'm afraid. It's TBA still.
So it might be...
It might be my bum is a peach. You never know. You know, keep holding out that hope. keep those letters going to the showmakers so that we finally get our episode, My Bum is a Peach. You know, it makes sense, folks. Take care. Cheerio, bye.
Bye.
I see the crystal raindrops fall, and the beauty of it all is when the sun comes shining through to make those rainbows in my mind. When I think of you sometime, and I want to spend some time with you, just the two of us.
The art for Borgcast Lower Decks is the fantastic work of Charlie Thorburn.
All music referenced is for illustrative purposes only, and no copyright infringement is intended.
Find our website at borgcast.libsyn.com.
We have a Facebook group which you're welcome to join.
You can find the Borgcast playouts on Spotify for your listening pleasure.
Visit our Tumblr site at borgcast.tumblr.com, where you'll find images accompanying the episodes discussed in this cast.
Send emails or MP3s to borgcast@gmail.com.
Or you can contact us via Twitter on rev_org or borgcastammo. Hashtag Borgcast.
Just the two of us. We can make it if we try. Just the two of us.
Just the two of us.
Just the two of us. Building them castles in the sky. Just the two of us. You and I.
Shut it down!